Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ooh, hallelujah. Somebody in this room knows what I'm talking about this morning. Come on, just go ahead and praise him for a minute. Come on, go ahead. You know how amazing he is. Somebody sitting beside you may not know because they've not experienced him. You may have to say, excuse me for just a minute because he brought me out of the miry pit. Excuse me for just a second while I give him praise. He healed me. He delivered me. Excuse me just a second. Sorry this morning. I know you look pretty and your hair is fixed this morning, but excuse me this morning. I came to praise an amazing God this morning. He's amazing. He's awesome. He's incredible. He's the King of Kings. He's the Lord of Lords. He's the Alpha, the Omega. He's the beginning and the end. Others have tried to be like him, but they'll never be him. Come on, somebody. He's amazing. Come on, just could you give him a hand clap? He's amazing. Hallelujah. While you're standing, turn around and pick up your Bible. Turn with me, if you would, this morning to Exodus chapter 20. And then we'll go to 1 Kings chapter 18. Thank you for coming to church today. I said thank you for coming to church today. Exodus chapter 20. Then 1 Kings chapter 18. And I want to say this before I start this morning, because this morning will probably not be a pew-jumping sermon. And in fact, I'll probably get some negative responses, but that'll be all right. Before I read the scripture this morning, I just want to make one thing very clear before we start this morning, that we are to love the sinner. Yes. In our nation today, they are trying to squelch what you and I are doing right now. Because they say that what you and I are doing is hostile towards others, when in fact they do not understand the love that the Christian has. They're watching around the world. You better say amen. They don't understand the love that the Christian has, and they don't understand the love that Jesus Christ had when he went to the cross for you and I. They call us judgmental. They call us hateful. They call us cruel. This morning, I want to make very, very clear that we love the sinner, but we hate the sin. Exodus chapter 20, verse 1 through 17. And you see there in the very first verse, the scripture said, and God spoke all these words. Yeah. Not your pastor.
No.
Not your neighbor or your spouse.
No.
Scripture said, and God spoke all these words, saying, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Verse 3, you shall have no other gods before me. We have made many gods. We've made a little green piece of paper our God. We have made spouses our God. We have made things our God. In fact, today in America, we have so many things that folks have gotten to be made very wealthy of building rental facilities for us to put our things in. I heard someone say just this week that owns a multitude of those rental facilities that said the very high percentage of what people put in those places and pay for it would never even sell at a garage sale. You shall have no other things, no other gods before me. Verse 4, you shall not make for yourselves a carved image, any likeness of anything that is in heaven above or that is in earth on earth beneath. Or that is in the water under the earth, you shall not bow down to them or serve them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children to the third and fourth generations of those who hate me, but showing mercy to thousands, to those who love me and keep my commandments. Verse 7, you shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. For the Lord will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain. Verse 8, remember the Sabbath day. Keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do your work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. 6 days, do what you need to do, but on the seventh day, that's his day.
Hold on.
That's his day. But the seventh day is the Sabbath day of your Lord God. In it you shall do no work, you nor your son, nor your daughter, nor your male servant, nor your female servant, nor your cattle, nor your stranger who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them, and rested the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. Verse 12, honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long upon the land which the Lord your God has given you. Verse 13, you shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife. Nor his male servant, nor his female servant, nor his ox, nor his donkey, nor anything that is your neighbors.
That's it.
Pastor, that's tough.
Yes, sir.
God did not set, hold on, I'm not finished. God did not set commandments in place to cause your life to be a dull life.
That's right.
He put commandments in place to protect you and I.
Yes, sir.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
1 Kings chapter 18, verse 21. You know this story, but we'll pull this verse out for our focus this morning. 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 21, Elijah went before the people and said, How long will you waver between two opinions? Some translations say two options. How long will you waver between two options? If the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal is God, follow him. And the people said nothing. I want to speak to you from the subject this morning for a few moments. And they said nothing. Lord, thank you for your presence that we felt already in this room. Thank you, Lord, this morning that you are an amazing God. You have done amazing things, and we trust this morning that you will continue to do amazing things. Open our ears this morning to hear what thus saith the Lord, and we'll be sure to give you all the praise and all the glory. And everybody said,
amen.
God bless you as you're seated. You know the story in 1 Kings chapter 18 very well. I'll read the scripture to you again because this is a very staggering response. The prophets of Baal have been called. The line has been drawn. Elijah went before the people. He went before God's people and said, how long are you going to go back and forth? How long are you going to believe this way one day and this way the next day? How long are you going to serve God today and because of a difficulty fall away tomorrow? How long are you going to waver back and forth? If the Lord is God, Elijah said, then follow him. Follow means to put all your effort with. Follow means, if you'll let me say it this way, to put all your eggs in one basket. If God is God, then follow him. But if Baal is God, follow him. And the people said nothing. How many of you today would say that you believe this is the infallible word of God? How many of you trust? Come on, you're one way or the other. We're not wavering today. How many of you trust that this is the infallible, inerrant, spoken word of God? And it makes no mistake. I said it makes no mistakes. There was a great artist, a famous artist, who wanted to paint a picture of his very best friend, of his Christian friend. Both of these guys are believers. And so he wanted to paint a picture of his friend. And when he finally did talk the man into letting him paint his picture, it turned out incredibly horrible. One of the most foulest, ugliest pictures of this man had ever been taken. And the man said to the renowned artist, this is the worst picture of me ever. Ugly, he said, absolutely dreadful. Why have you painted in your abilities to paint wonderful paintings? Why in your such great ability have you painted such an ugly, dreadful picture of me? And the artist replied, I just want you to see what you would look like without Christ in your life. That is exactly where America is today. I said, that is exactly where America is today and where we are headed as a nation. What you're seeing today is a picture that is being painted of a nation that is without Christ, where you have people that can't figure out what restroom they want to use. You have people that can't figure out what partner they want to marry or that they should marry or which is the right one to marry. Come on, am I in the church today? We have a picture of America today that has turned its back on Christ. And if you think it's ugly today, think about it, just hang around. Yes, it gets a whole lot worse. Yes, Psalm chapter 139 and verse 13 through 16 says, for you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Put the clock up. Let me start it over. I want you to get this scripture. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them ever came to be. That tells me this morning that while you were still dust blowing across the ground, before you were ever a twinkle in your mother's eye, that God Himself, I said, God Himself had all of your days written out before you ever drew your first breath this morning. Let me tell you today, everything's going according to plan. I said, everything is going according to plan in your life because the God of heaven took a heavenly pen, if you will, and He wrote out every single day of your pastor. But it's difficult. It may be difficult, but if you'll turn the page, there's victory coming your way this morning because God has written the story of your life. He said, you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my father's womb. Let me tell you this morning, life begins at conception. I said, here's where some of you just turned me off. I said, life begins at conception. It doesn't begin when the doctor cuts a cord. It doesn't begin when they declare it to be a boy or a girl. It doesn't, it doesn't begin when they say you got twins or you got one. Life begins at conception. And the Christian said, you created. Some of you have already turned it off. And the people said nothing. You created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. God didn't make a mistake. His works are wonderful. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place. When I was woven together in the depths of the earth, your eyes saw my unformed. My God. Abortion has claimed over 57 million babies in our country alone since Roe versus Wade. That's 884,344 deaths or murders just this year alone. Let me read that to you again. 884,344 murders this year alone. That means a baby dies every 29 seconds. There goes another one. Here starts another one. That means in America today, I told you we wouldn't jump pews. That means in America today, we have killed 57 million lives. 57 million lives. That means a baby every 29 seconds in America alone. Could one have been the next presidential candidate? Ronald Reagan said, I see those that are talking about abortion or against abortion today are ones that are alive or have already been born. Could one have found a cure for cancer? Could one have run a successful business or could one have been the doctor that saved your loved one's life? Proverbs chapter 31, verse 8 through 9. Says, open your mouth for the speechless in the cause of all who are appointed to die. Open your mouth, judge righteously, and plead the cause of the poor and needy. But Elijah said, and the people said nothing. There are some excuses as to why we have arrived at over 57 million in this country alone. Let me give them to you this morning. 74% said having a baby would dramatically change my life. You should have thought about that before you You finish the sentence.
Say it, Pastor.
73% said, I can't afford a baby right now. Well, if you can't afford a baby right now, then quite possibly you can't afford yourself. 48% said, I don't want to be a single mother or have future relationship problems because I have a baby. 32% said, I'm not ready for another child. 25% said they did not want people to know that they have been having sex.
Think about it.
Well, they already know.
Think about it.
57 million. Mark chapter 10. Verse 6 through 12. But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female.
That's it.
It's okay. We're almost past the bad part, so you can clap. Everybody's too scared to say anything. But from the beginning of creation, that means from Genesis, God made them male and female. It just makes sense. I'll leave that right there too. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife. And the two shall become one flesh, so then they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no man separate. In the house, his disciples also asked him again about the same matter. So he said to them, whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if a woman divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery. In America, there is one divorce. And listen to me this morning. If you've been through a divorce, I'm not here today to condemn you. I said, I'm not here today to condemn. I'm not here to judge you. I understand things that happen in abusive situations and so on. But in America today, there is one divorce approximately every 36 seconds. That's nearly 2,400 divorces per day. That's 16,800 divorces per week. And that's 800,076 divorces in a year in America. The average length of a marriage that ends in divorce is 8 years. Some don't even make it 8 days. The average for couples going through their first divorce in America today is 30 years old. Today, 60% of all marriages are preceded by a period of cohabitation. I'm going to say that again. 60% of all marriages in America today are preceded by a period of cohabitation. Researchers suggest that couples live together as a way of trying out marriage to test the compatibility with their partners. What happened to prayer? What happened to prayer? Now we just shack up, and when we get all we need or all we want.
Say it, Pastor, say it.
I told you we wouldn't. While still having the option of ending the relationship, most that cohabitate do it for reasons because of legal implications. We don't want legal problems. More than 3/4 of all cohabitators report plans to marry their partners, which implies that most of them view cohabitation as a prelude to marriage. As we open this scripture today, and listen, there are many, many more things I can talk about this morning. So in your mind this morning, you're thinking, is he preaching on politics? Is he trying to get me to vote? What is he trying to do? Yes to all of the above. $55 million so-called Christians stayed at home in the last election cycle. I said 55 million of us stayed home in the last, but we are quick to complain and we're quick to go to Starbucks. Listen, and Elijah said, and the people said nothing. Nobody said a word. As we look at the scripture this morning, I would like for you to note that the picture, I want you to see this morning the picture of indecision on the part of the people at this point. This morning, again, I'm not preaching to you about politics, but I'm trying to bring you to a point of somebody's got to say something. Somebody's got to stand up for what is right. I said, if you are a believer today, then the decision should have already been made that I am for life. I am for godly marriage. I want you to notice this morning the picture of indecision. Today, this should be a strong challenge to you and I to make a decision for God. The call of God is for us to make a decision for Christ and to study His holy word, learning His commandments, and grow into mature believers. Let me say that again. The call of God upon our lives. Set aside pastor and missionary and nursery worker and all of those things. The first call of God upon your life and my life is to study His holy word and learn His commandments and grow into being a mature believer. So that when decisions come and need to be made, because I am a mature believer and I understand what the word of God says and I know what the will of God says, then I am able to make a decision just like that. But we listen to Oprah. We listen to Dr. Phil. We listen to everybody else. We vote with the majority of who our buddies are voting for and just what sounds the best. Listen to me this morning. God will not tolerate indecision. And He will not stand for the wrong decision. Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 14 says, then we will no longer be infants tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning craftiness of men in their deceitful scheming. I want to read that again because you've got to get it this morning. Then we will no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves. We have people today that they bounce from church to church to church to church. They like that worship. They like that preaching. They like that altar service. They like this. And they are as confused as a termite in a yo-yo. Listen, the scripture said that I am no longer to be an infant, that I am to get somewhere and to stay planted. Well, I know this is not going well. Blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of men in their deceitful scheming. That doesn't just mean men and their deceitful scheming out there. As a Christian, I am to have my mind made up so that He is my Savior, so that He is my King, so that He is the great I Am, so that He is amazing, so that He saved me, so that He filled me with the Holy Ghost. I'm to have my mind made up that He was a healer yesterday, He's a healer today, and He'll be a healer tomorrow. God hath delivered, He doth deliver, and He will yet deliver. If He saved yesterday, He's a Savior today, and He'll be a Savior tomorrow. If He was good to me yesterday, He'll be good to me today, and He's going to be good to me tomorrow. If He protected me yesterday, He's going to protect me today, and He's going to protect me tomorrow. If the storm came yesterday, the wind may blow today, but God's going to protect me. I am to have my mind made up. Bible said that in the end times that there will be a great shaking, and we are seeing it. Listen, right now. What can be shaken is being shaken. What can fall away is falling away. But the Bible still rings true when Jesus said, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail. There'll be people fall away, but God still has a remnant. I said God still has a remnant of Holy Ghost filled people. Indecision. We can't make up our mind. I want to go here or go there or follow him or follow her. Today, this should be a challenge to you. David said in Psalms chapter 101, verse 3 through 8. You understand David wrote this after what he has been through. Come on, he was in a place that he should not have been, watching a woman he shouldn't have been watching, and got himself in trouble. He got himself right. He made himself right with God. We get over to Psalm 101, verse 3 through 8, and here is what David said. He said, I will set before my eyes no vile thing. The enemy caught me before, but he's not going to catch me again. I was just half committed before, but now I understand the tricks of the devil, and I will set no vile thing before my eyes. The deeds of faithless men, he said, I hate. They will not cling to me. Men of perverse heart shall be far from me. I will have nothing to do with evil. Whoever slanders his neighbor in secret, him I will put to silence. Whoever has haughty eyes and a proud heart, him I will not endure. My eyes will be on the faithful in the land. They may dwell with me. Whose walk is blameless will minister to me. No one who practices deceit will dwell in my house. No one who speaks falsely will stand in my presence. Every morning I will put to silence all the wicked in the land. I will cut off every evildoer from the city of the Lord. What David said is, I know where God brought me from. I know you got me one time, devil, but you're never going to get me again. I may have been half committed standing on that roof that day, but from this day forward, I'm marching toward a city. I said, I'm marching toward a city. No matter what everybody else does, no matter who else somebody votes for, no matter what party they're from, my party is heaven. I said, my party is heaven, and I'm marching to that city. Ooh, David said, you got me once, but you're not going to get me again. Blanche is back. He said, the bar had me, but today Jesus has got me. He said addiction had me, but today I'm addicted to Jesus. He said the devil had a hold around my neck, but today Jesus has my hand. He said hell had my name and was headed for me, but today my name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Point number one. God warns against indecision.
Yes, he does.
Have you ever been, now just look straight forward, don't. You get in your car after church with your family, and you know you're going to eat. Are y'all going to eat when you leave here? Me and her, that's it. Rest of y'all fasting for us. You know you're going to go eat. We may not come to an altar, but we know we're going to eat. So we get in the car, and we're driving down the road, and you know you're going to eat. And so the very first thing you say is, y'all are ahead of me. Where do y'all want to go? Oh, we don't care. Wherever you want to go. Lie number one. Because I'll go home every time. When I married Joni, or before, when I asked her to marry me, I said, look, you don't have to be a good cook. All you got to do is have mayonnaise, bread, and turkey, and I'm good to go. You don't have to cook all day long. You don't have to sweat. You don't have to grow a massive garden. That would be nice. I'm thinking, I didn't say it. And we've been married 17 years today. Happy anniversary. 16 years of the best years of our life. 16 years of the best years. That first one was demonic. Let's just say it that. Anybody else identify? Some of you are too spiritual to raise your hand, but some of you are still demonic right now, and you won't even. Ooh, that first one was bad. I told her, I said, look, you don't have to cook. I'm good to go. All you have to do is have turkey and mayonnaise, bread. I'll drink water. And occasionally some chili and crackers. And it doesn't even, it can be canned chili. And I'm good. So that's lie number one. Wherever you want to go. We get just about down the hill. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm not talking about our car. I'm talking about your car. We get just about down the hill headed towards Casey's. The red light's coming, and you know that you can see a very few restaurants. Where would y'all like to go? We don't care. Where do you want to go, so-and-so? Almost said a name. Where would you like to go, so-and-so? Oh, I don't care. Wherever you want to go. Where do you want to go, so-and-so? I don't care. Wherever he wants to go. By the time I get to the red light, I am in a mode of, would somebody make up their mind? I know already right now, standing right here, this very second, what I want for lunch. Uh-oh. We're driving whatever you want, and it comes back full circle in the vehicle. Am I in your car? I'm in your car. Okay, good. Today's my anniversary, so I'm in your car today, not in mine. Wherever you want to go. So it makes full circle back to me. Well, you're driving, so wherever the car stops, that's where we'll eat. Lie number two. Because you just act like you're going to pull into the convenience store. Because a bag of chips and a Coke will do. No, 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 I don't want that. I have said before, okay, you don't care what we eat today. So today we're going to have squirrel. We're going to have pig's feet. No, I'm not having that. Okay, so it does make a difference to you what we have. I'm going to get on. I'm making the point here. Somebody make up your mind. God warns against indecision. And I want you to look at this morning. As soon as all the people and all the false prophets had gathered, Elijah stood before them and presented his challenge, explaining the contest. Then Elijah said to them, I am the only one of the Lord's prophets left, but Baal has 450 prophets. Get two bulls for us. Let them choose. choose one for themselves and let them cut it into pieces and put it on the wood and set it on fire. I will prepare the other bull and put wood on it and set it on fire. Then you call on the name of your God, and I'll call on the name of the Lord, and the God who answers by fire, he is God. And the people all said, what you say is good. Somebody's got to make a decision for right today. You must stand up for, as a believer today, you either today have got to serve God and serve his word and serve who he is, or you serve Baal. But first he rebuked the people, Elisha did, in wavering between two options. No longer could they debate between the truth and the living God, who the true and living God was. No longer could they claim that all gods were equal, that all gods represented the one true living God. No longer could they serve both Lord and Baal. It was time for the people to make a decision. Time to make a forceful and conclusive declaration that the Lord was the one and only true God, and all other so-called gods were false. In other words, the people could no longer straddle the fence. They could no longer limp along between two options. Let me tell you, in America today, we are coming down to a place where you better have already made your decision. I said, you better have already made your decision, because one openly said, I am after the religious, I'm after the evangelicals, I'm after the church, because they disagree. Are you listening to what I'm saying? They disagree with mine and your belief, while the other one said, I'm all for it. It doesn't take long for me to make my decision today. In other words, they must now decide to take a stand for the Lord and declare truth. That he alone is the true and living God. And that is what we must do today and now. Ten amens. We have people sitting in this sanctuary and have sat in this sanctuary for years, have never said one word.
My God.
We are afraid of what people will think. I've weighed all the options before this morning, and I had already made my decision before I started studying. It's my right as a believer. It's my responsibility as a believer to stand up and say something. He stood up for me. He stood up for you. And he said something on the way to Golgotha's hill that day. He drug that cross for you. He shed his blood for you. He stood up for you. And he shouted salvation to you. Why can't we stand up and say something for Jesus today? While you were an adulterer, he stood up. While you were drunk, he stood up. While you were addicted, he stood up. While you were prideful, he stood up. While you were arrogant, he stood up. Even though you were snobby, he stood up. When you were sleeping with somebody else, he stood up for you. Why can't we stand up for him? He could have called all of heaven down. He said, if God, this be your will, then I'll do this. He had an option to back out on you, but he never backed out on you. You have an option now. And Elijah said, you choose this day whom you're going to serve. So-called Pentecost, Holy Ghost filled people, yeah, sat around with their mouths shut. Yeah. Divide churches. That's what we're into.
My God.
You better say amen. Might as well go on and go there. We divide churches. We argue. We fight. Oh, I don't like him. I don't like him. And I don't like her. Well, they may not like you either. We don't want to argue over the carpet color. We want to argue over this. We want to argue over the music. We want to argue over that. While all along he never made no... He never ever said a thing bad about you while he was dragging that cross, while they kicked him and they spit on him, they cursed him, they ostracized him, they rejected him, while all along he had you in mind. I wonder, can the church stand up for Jesus today? Can we stand up? Oh, if I take a stand, I'll lose my place. So your place is more important than your stand. Ooh, you let the Razorbacks make the wrong choice in a coach. We can't shut up. But when it comes to Jesus, if I take a stand, I'm liable to lose their contract. If I take a stand, I'm liable to lose their money. If I take a stand, I'm liable to lose their membership. If I take a stand, I'm liable to lose their tithe. Listen, if I lose you now, I never had you to begin with. I said, if I lose you now, it's not money that attracts me. It's not popularity that attracts me. I didn't come to be popular. I came to praise Jesus. I came to load this ark and take this city to heaven. I don't care about the color of the carpet. I don't care how much you make. What I want to know is, how is your soul with Jesus Christ? If you're not with me now, you're not going to be with me. And if you're not with him now, you're not going to be with him. But what I'm going to do in this church is I'm responsible to preach it straight down the middle of the road. And that's exactly what I'm going to do, whether they leave or whether they stay. Whether... I had a lady in my previous church left. Are y'all surprised? See ya. I've not ever been in the habit of chasing folks. If you want to go, happy trails to you. I've seen preachers chase millionaires. I've seen preachers chase money. I've seen preachers chase influencers, while all along there's somebody that just came from the pit sitting on the front of their pew, and they never pay attention to them. Listen, I'm not concerned. God said, I'll provide for my church. If you'll take care of my business, I'll always take care of your business. The church ought to be into souls. I said, we ought to be into souls. Lady left my church in Houston. Didn't tell me. You know, most leave that way. They don't have the guts to come stand in your face and say, Pastor, I'm going to go. They gather them a bunch of folks before they go, and then they go out the door. They can't email. They can't talk to you. They just go out the door with others. And that's what she did. And so I called her. It was just one of those days, and I thought, you're going to talk to me today. If I have to come to your house, you're going to talk to me. Because you talk to everybody else but me. Now my email box is full. I got a calendar full of people who want to see me, what you said. So if you can say it to them, you can stand right here and say it. So I thought, you're going to talk to me today. So I called her and called her till she finally answered the phone. I said, I don't want to know anything else. I just want you to tell me why you left? She said, well, I left because at the end of every one of your altar services, you beg for people to come to an altar. I said, I'm sorry. She said, at the end of an altar service, she said, either you've reached the point of trying to twist people's arm behind their back to get them to come to an altar, or you'll beg them, or you'll plead with them to come to an altar. And she said, I don't want to be in a church no longer like that. At that point, I know she's gone, so I might as well go on and help her a little. I said, well, let me say to you, ma'am, you have children, and I'm responsible in part for their eternal security. And let me ask you a question. If I were to be walking down the street in your neighborhood today, and your house is engulfed in flames on fire, and it appears as though there's no fireman, and your house is about to burn to the ground, and I'm walking by on the sidewalk watching your house burn, and I see your children upstairs, there's no way down, there's no way out, your children can't get out, would you want me to help them out of that fire, or would you want me to let them burn to death while I'm standing there with a ladder in my hand? Let me tell you, ma'am, if that's offensive to you, then you better get your going shoes going, because my responsibility as a leader, my responsibility as a pastor, is to bring people to the point of a decision. And it could quite possibly be that your kids may be in a church one day and you don't want a pastor to have an altar service. Then let me help you find another church, because this one's not for you. But the people said nothing. Not a word. This was the church. They were completely unwilling to respond to the challenge, and they were unwilling to make a decision for Christ. I want you to keep in mind today that Baal was thought to be the god of fertility and production, the god who controlled the weather, including the clouds, the rain, the storms, and the dew. You see, sometimes things aren't really what they seem to be. The gods we serve today are money, power, success, sex. Which will not only wind up getting us in trouble, but will get others in trouble as well. Let me read some scriptures to you. I hadn't got to point number two yet. Come encourage them. He's just playing. I'm not done. You know, when he comes up here, that means absolutely nothing, don't you? Boy, somebody turned the heater on in here today. It's not winter yet. Second Kings chapter 17, verse 40 through 41. They would not listen, however, but persisted in their former practices. Even while these people were worshiping the Lord, they were serving their idols. And to this day, the scripture says, their children and grandchildren continue to do the same as their fathers did. Let me tell you today, church, this isn't in my notes, but I just felt prompted by the Holy Spirit to stop right there. Whatever you do, your kids will do. Whatever you do, your kids are going to do. And if you notice, I don't have time to preach on this, but every time sin went from generation to generation, it was 100 times worse in the next generation than it was in the previous. Come on, say amen. Some of you folks sitting around got a little snow on the roof. They used to hide in the closet and just take a sip of some of that whiskey made over here in the mountains. Say amen. You know they did. We're not sipping anymore. We're full-blown guzzlers now. And then come to church and act like we don't do it. Woo, you may have it hid from the preacher, but you don't have it hid from God. If you cause division, your kids will cause division. You talk about the leadership, your kids are going to talk about the leadership. Whatever you do, your kids are going to do it. Even while, the scripture said, even while these people were worshiping the Lord, they were serving their idols. And to this day, their children and grandchildren do the very same thing. Matthew chapter 6, verse 24, the words of Jesus said, no one can serve two masters. Either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. What Jesus is saying here is there's no split decision. Matthew chapter 30, I'm sorry, chapter 12, verse 30. Again, the words of Jesus said, he who is not with me is against me. And he who does not gather with me scatters. The Message translation, notice I said, because I'll get in trouble for using the Message translation. I didn't say Message Bible. I said Message translation. That's what it is. Took that scripture and said this. This is war. And there is no neutral ground. If you're not on my side, you're the enemy. If you're not helping, you're making things worse. I want you to know this morning that it is impossible to be neutral about Christ. Well, I thought the church would have said amen. It's impossible to be neutral about Christ. A person who is not actively following him is choosing to reject him. A person who tries to remain neutral in the struggle of good against evil is choosing to be separated from God and refuse to follow Christ. Is to choose to be on the enemy's team. You can look at your phone later. Would you please put your phone up? Unless you're taking notes. It's time for a decision. I said it's time for a decision. We are coming down. Listen. We are living in Bible times. We're not waiting for it. You're in it. Prophecy is being fulfilled right in front of your eyes. I said to someone the other day that in the past 2 years, I have never seen, I'm 44. I wish I was, well, I don't know. Can't find a good age. I've never seen things move as fast as they have in the past 2 years. And if the one gets in, they believe is going to get in. It's going to move a whole lot faster. Openly has said, I am for everything I have just talked to you about this morning. And believers will go and check yes. It's a decision for murder. It's a decision for wrong. Pastor, don't tell me. I'm not telling you. He already told you. I didn't tell you. If you're a believer and you are a student, then he already told you. It's impossible to be neutral. It is impossible. Listen, I'm going to talk to you straight today. I up half the night and all week knowing what I was going to say today, and I've lightened up on some of it. It's impossible to have slept with your girlfriend last night, and if Jesus comes today, you make it to heaven. Impossible. It's impossible to be committing adultery and come here today and sit in this sanctuary and think just because you were here, everything's going to be all right. It's impossible. It's impossible to have unforgiveness in your heart, thinking that it's someone else's fault, while all along that unforgiveness is like a cancer eating away at you, and you sit there and think, I'm going to heaven, praise God. The Bible said if you have aught in your heart against your brother, to lay your gift at the altar and go take care of the aught with your brother, because your gift is unacceptable unto me. Go take care of the aught, and then you come back and pick up your gift, and then I will accept. I don't care who you are. I don't care how long you've been around. Unforgiveness and division will cause you to bust hell wide open. Stop fooling yourself. Pastor, this is old time preaching. Ooh, I can't sit still. I'm ready to go. I'm talking to you. The Holy Spirit. Oh, me. Point number two, real fast. God has called us to speak out. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 10 through 14 says, find out what pleases the Lord and have nothing to do with fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather expose them. We must speak out for what is right. It's time to call a spade, and stop tiptoeing around, walking on eggshells, thinking we're going to hurt somebody's feelings. Ooh, I've had my feelings hurt. And now I've been pastoring so long, I don't even have any more feelings. Somebody said something the other day to me, and they said, I hope that didn't hurt your feelings. I said, no worries. They're all gone. I'd rather hurt your feelings and let conviction fill your heart than to preach an empty gospel to you and let you walk out of here the same way you walked in this building. I'd rather my email box tomorrow be full. I'd rather you sit at Starbucks and talk bad about me. Hey, it's going on right now. And the funny thing is, every single one, they always think it's never going to get back to me. And it always does. Somebody is always willing to tell on you. Silence can be interpreted as approval. Silence is consent. Psalm 107, verse 2 through 9, and I won't read it all to you for the sake of time. I'm trying to close here. The scripture said, then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them out of their distresses. And he led them forth by the right way, that they might go to a city for a dwelling place. I want to tell you this morning, church, he is the answer for our troubles. And finally, number three, a decision must be made. Now is the time to step forward. In fact, I'm not sure if we're already too late. In fact, we may be too late. The enemy has sat back and tricked the church for years. We are the only institution that kills its wounded. We're the only, it's almost a human form of cannibalism, a spiritual form of cannibalism. We have eat our wounded alive. We've seen the preacher make a mistake and we have shredded him. A pastor just down the road from me in Houston, just before we left, preached Sunday morning, went home and killed himself in his bedroom. Shot himself in the head. Large church. Because he was dealing with depression from things going on in his congregation. And instead of people coming alongside, they stood back and fueled. The enemy has tricked the church. Don't think everybody else. I'm preaching here. Has tricked the church, and we have argued and we've fought and we've opinionated and we've yang and we yang about everything. And now it's too late. Joshua said, Joshua chapter 24 and verse 15, but if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, he said, if you just can't do this, then choose for yourself this day whom you will serve, whether the gods of your forefathers served beyond the river or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are still living. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Just because everybody else is doing it doesn't mean the Brooks house is going to do it. Just because everybody else goes to R-rated movie don't mean we're going. Just because everybody... Well, that's not popular. There's an old story of a remarkable account of a destruction of an ancient city. And I'm done here, I promise. The watchmen on the walls would call out whenever they thought they saw an enemy approaching. Sensing that the people had begun to resent them for giving false alarms, they decided to remain quiet. Regrettably, not long afterward, the enemy actually did come. The enemy sent a small group of men to test the defenses of that wall. Because they were just a few men, the watchmen thought them to be no danger. The walls were high and the city was strong, and the watchmen were not sure if they were the enemy or not. And the watchmen, fearing the scorn of the town, gave no alarm and remained silent. Then the enemy moved his main force in and attacked the city. The city that could have been saved was assaulted and devastated, and nothing was left but smoke and ruins. Later, someone placed a small memorial outside at the city gate that said, "Here stood a town that was destroyed by silence." Elijah said, and the people said nothing. You and I cannot afford to be silent about the sin that surrounds us. We must step forward and speak up and take a stand for Him. Gideon grew his church from 30,000 to 300. Just give me 300. Here's the answer. Here's the answer to the entire thing. We're looking to an election. We're looking to people. We're looking to man. Here's the answer to the entire thing. And isn't it awesome that it's not on Oprah and it's not on Dr. Phil and it's not on the 5 o'clock news? It's in a little place called your Bible. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and forgive their sins, and I will heal their land. You'll know the answer. I just read it to you. It's called repentance. It's called repentance. And here's what's going to happen right here, right now. And here's what will happen around millions of churches all around the world today. The truth will be preached. The gospel will be heard. And people will be brought to a point of decision. And they will say nothing. And walk right out the door the same way they came in. Jesus is coming. Oh, Pastor, I've heard it and heard it and heard it. Good. Could be on a day just like today. You must make a decision. Either you serve the Lord God or you serve Baal. It's a decision you have to make. Lord, thank you. Lord, I feel the weight of this lift off me now. Because I've said what you have dealt with me about all week. It's off of me, Lord. Now, it's your turn. The Holy Spirit to go and convict souls sitting here in this room and those that may be watching us around the world. Lord, it's time for a decision. Lord, help us to have a courage. Help us to have a boldness. Help us to get past the past. Lord, the past has been our great enemy. Help us, Lord, to get past the past. We have today only. You didn't even guarantee us tomorrow. Today is the point of decision. The scripture said today is the day of salvation, not tomorrow. And not when I get good and ready. Today, you said, is the day. Help us, God, as a nation to repent. Help us, Lord, as a nation. Help us as a church. It starts with the church first. Help us as a church, God, to come to a place to say we are sorry for turning our back. We're sorry for dividing. We're sorry for fighting. We're sorry because we've pushed you out. We're sorry, Lord. You're our only answer. You're our only answer. With every head bowed and every eye closed, I know today was heavy. Come back tonight. We'll shout. We'll have church. But today, sir, no matter who you are, whether you're sitting on the front row or the last row of the balcony, the far right side or the far left side, you have a decision to make. If you choose, as Joshua said, to serve the Lord, then you serve him with your whole heart. If not, and you choose to serve Baal, you choose to serve the enemy, then by all means, go do it with all your heart. But it'll never be said that in this house you didn't have a point of decision. who would be honest in this room and today and say, Pastor, I want to serve the Lord. I want to give my heart to God. I want to live right and do right, and I need His help to do that. That's me, Pastor. I want to be saved. Maybe you never have been. Maybe you've walked out on God, and you say, Pastor, that's me. If that's you, raise your hand right now. Don't wait 1 second. Don't wait 1 second. Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Somebody else. Don't wait 1 second. Come on, right now is the time. This is the day. You're not guaranteed even to make it to lunch. Come on, I'm going to. Come on, the church is praying. There's people in this room, you're living in an adulterous relationship. There's people in this room. You're committing fornication, you have, which is sex before marriage. There's people in this room, you've got addictions. There's people in this room, you have problems that if the closet door was open, you'd say, I don't want anybody to know. Listen, you've got to get those under the shed blood of Jesus Christ. It's not about what you've done. It's about getting it under the blood of Jesus Christ. Come on, raise your hand now and say, Pastor, that's me. I want to be saved. We're not going to embarrass you. We'd never do anything to hurt you. Pastor, that's me. Thank you, sir. I need some people that are altar workers to come right now, because there's going to be people to come pray. Come on, if you're all, you pray, come on. If you raised your hand and said, that's me, I want you to stand and come right now. There's somebody here to pray with you. Here comes a gentleman. Come on, sir. Reach over and get her by the hand and come down. Come on. The Bible said, if you'll not acknowledge me before man, I'll not acknowledge you before the Father. Come on, church, pray. Don't just look around. There's souls in the balance. Somebody's trying to make a decision. Come on, sir, reach over, pick her up, pick her hand up, and say, I'll go with you. You made one step to raise your hand and say, that's me. Come on, make the next step and come. Come on, don't sit there. Come. Thank you for coming. Here he comes. Y'all lead him to Jesus. Come on, ma'am. He came, you come. Here comes some more. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, people are making a decision for Christ this morning. Here's another one. Hallelujah, church. What a glorious day this is when somebody gives their life. Now here's the second part. We've watched them come. Now we're the church. And what the church ought to do today is stand and come and do exactly what I just read to you. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked ways, this ought to be 100% of everybody in this room. If you are a believer, you ought to be on your feet, making your way to this altar. Not to your car, but to this altar.